Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to be discussing the Indiana Pacers rebuild situation. But before we get started with all that, I want to give a quick shout out to a subscriber today, as always. And today, it's going to be Jonathan Rounds. Thank you, bro, so much for like, commenting, subscribing, turn on post notification, and just showing so much love and support towards the YouTube channel and the podcast overall. We greatly appreciate that. Now, let's talk about Pacers basketball, because obviously, you know, they have put out a product that has not been all that consumable for, you know, Indiana Pacers fans thus far this season. I mean, they're currently 12-16 on the year, the 13th seed in the Eastern Conference, and you know, they've digressed severely coming into the year. This was a team that, you know, had playoff aspirations. They brought in coach Rick Carlisle, who, you know, is well known for, you know, making it to the postseason year in and year out, despite him not having much success in winning a playoff series since the 2011 matchup with the Miami Heat. But I digress. But essentially, you know, this is a Pacers team that has just kind of stayed in the middle for the better half of the last decade. And it seems like, you know, the rest of the conference has definitely caught up with them, because they've been doing a great job in terms of, you know, just drafting, bringing in the proper pieces, and, you know, being aggressive during free agency. And, you know, Indiana, they're one of the lesser markets in the entire NBA. So free agency, we're not going to get any home run hitters in terms of a Zach LaVine, a Damian Lillard, or Bradley Beal. So we kind of have to go for those low ball players that, you know, can not necessarily change the overall dynamic of what we do, but, you know, just contribute to that and hopefully pray that we can just progress in those standpoints. With all that being said, Indiana, they just, even with that being said, they have not done a great job in terms, you know, just bringing in the proper pieces that are even going to be marginal enough to, you know, help this team progress. We've seen them losing a first round 6 years in a row, and, you know, there hasn't been much of a change. And, you know, with the history of Indiana not also being that well organized in terms, you know, just putting out a product that everybody enjoys, and the players seem like they've been unhappy for the better half of the last 3 to 4 seasons, I think that is all a result and a culmination as to why, you know, the Pacers are now a 13th seed in the Eastern Conference.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think the management is not aggressive enough. I mean, and they haven't really drafted well. I mean, besides Chris Duarte, I mean, these past few years, they haven't really drafted well. So bringing a guy like Chris Duarte was huge, but they need to figure out who they're going to build around. And I think retooling the roster is a great idea right now. It's been a recurring event since the Paul George era. They haven't been able to really figure out how they can bring in pieces from either via the draft or through free agency. And it's really been tough for these guys. And the management and the owner, Herb Simon, is really content with being average and filling seats and, you know, getting that bonus check for making the playoffs, but ultimately just losing in the first round. They just keep repeating this process over and over again. They haven't found the right coach. They let Nate McMillan walk out the door. Then they brought in another coach last year that didn't gel with the organization or the players. So they really need to find, you know, they really need to find something that really ignites this team, because right now they're just not on sync and the players are fighting with each other. Myles Turner is unhappy and people really don't understand their roles with the team. And I feel like they need to get back on track. So I think trading three guys like Caris LeVert, Myles Turner, and Sabonis will definitely go in the right directions to bring back some pieces to really retool this roster.
Yeah, and I'm a little bit worried about some of these guys' trade value, and it's not necessarily because, you know, they aren't that great of players, but it's more so has to do with things like health and fit, and is there a big need for your position in, you know, today's market currently right now. And in terms of a Caris LeVert, I don't think that there's a huge need for guards in the NBA in terms of, you know, teams trying to add, you know, some guys that are going to be able to provide production from that standpoint, because most of these teams in the NBA already have their backcourt kind of settled, whether you're talking about a contending team like the Milwaukee Bucks that features Chris Middleton and Drew Holiday, or you're talking about a rebuilding team like the Oklahoma City Thunder that features Shai Gilgeous-Alexander and Josh Giddey in their backcourt. Either way, most of these teams are kind of settled in on that standpoint, so it may be a little bit tough trying to get Caris LeVert dealt out of Indiana, and maybe we might even see a situation where he might not get dealt. I don't know the likelihood of that, but you know, you just never know, especially given his health history. I don't know too many teams that may want to be, you know, trying to pull the plug in terms of giving up some decent assets for a guy who, you know, just isn't always available nine times out of 10. But I mean, what are your thoughts on LeVert's trade value, essentially?
I think it's low just because, like you mentioned, the guards are kind of already set in all these teams' positions, and they like how they're, you know, trending in the right direction at the start of the season. And his contract, I mean, 2 years left on his deal with $17 million. I mean, that's a lot of money. A lot of contending teams don't have the, you know, the remaining money to really add him on the roster. But I mean, there's a couple teams that we could talk about as far as the Cavs, the Mavericks, and the Pelicans who, you know, who could add him and add his services if he's available. And I'm going to talk about the Cavs because I think that Colin Sexton, going down for the season and him having problems on court and off court with the players in the locker room, I think adding a guy next to Darius Garland on the perimeter who can, you know, create their own shot and put the ball in the basket can definitely help them on the perimeter for sure nicely.
Well, I mean, in terms of Caris LeVert, like you mentioned, the contract, don't know if I want to take that if I'm Cleveland, especially because, you know, I'm going to have to give up a lot of assets because there's not a lot of guys on, you know, multi-year contracts on the current roster as of right now. Second, you know, he doesn't really fit their timeline. They're not necessarily in win now mode. So I don't really see the need to acquire Caris LeVert. But I mean, I guess I kind of understand the concept, but I would love to see LeVert in a situation where he's probably in like Dallas or New Orleans. And I want to talk about Dallas first, because Dallas essentially has been looking for, you know, another guard that's going to be able to put the ball in the basket at a high and efficient rate and, you know, not necessarily run the offense because you have Luka Doncic and you have Jalen Brunson. Those guys can handle that. But they do need an additional score, an additional perimeter threat that, you know, teams are going to have to be attentive to because, you know, Tim Hardaway Jr., at times he can be hit or miss. I really like him as a player overall, but more than likely he should be a sixth man, not a starter. And in terms of, you know, just production comparing those two, I think I more than likely would favor, you know, Caris LeVert's skill set, especially when healthy. And in terms of the New Orleans Pelicans, this is an organization that, you know, they are trying to, you know, contend for the play-in tournament and things of that nature. And obviously, you know, the Valanciunas trade has put them in position to start to build this team in the right direction. You know, obviously when you get Zion Williamson back, hopefully he can give you the offensive production that he was able to give you last year, averaging 27 points per game off 61% from the field, which is just mind-boggling. And then obviously having Brandon Ingram, who's an all-star caliber player at the wing position. And then, you know, with your second unit, having a guy like Nickeil Alexander-Walker play alongside, you know, a Caris LeVert, and they can be a nice little tandem. Or you can interchange it with Kyra Lewis Jr., you name it. Pick your poison, essentially. But the next guy that I want to discuss is Domantas Sabonis. And I don't think that he will be dealt due to the fact that, you know, I know Indiana's going to pick between him and Myles Turner. And given the fact that, you know, Myles Turner has probably a better trade value and he essentially doesn't even want to be in Indiana anymore, I doubt, you know, they allow him to stay on the Pacers roster for any longer after the trade deadline and things of that nature. But Greg, let me hear your thoughts on Sabonis' trade value and some areas you would like to see him play for potentially.
Yeah, I think with Sabonis, I mean, he has the offensive versatility, he's a great passer. But I think people who's, you know, vying for a big, so I think the Hornets, I think he could work with the Spurs as well in that, in Greg Popovich's system. I mean, see what he did with Tim Duncan over there, but I think he could work there and the way they move the ball over there, I think he could work and bring his offensive talents over there. And I also think with the Hornets, I think on the offensive end, I think he can bring some versatility in their lineup with LaMelo pick and rolling. And picking and rolling with Sabonis, giving the ball in the mid post, him bringing the ball up in transition, stuff like that. I feel like he can fit the mold in with Charlotte. But defensively, I question because, you know, right now Sabonis plays along Turner because he cannot guard, you know, fours and fives. He struggles with that and with his movement on defense. So I do question with that. But I mean, other teams I've seen the Wizards, I've seen the Warriors. The Warriors I question just because I don't know how they're going to use him. He's a streaky shooter. He's not a consistent shooter. He does have a 10 to 15 foot range jump shot, but I just don't know with the Warriors how they run their actions, stuff like that, how they're going to get him involved, especially with Draymond Green on the court as well. So it would be interesting to see that. But I think the Spurs, Hornets, Wizards, or the Warriors would be one of my teams I would watch out for Sabonis.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of Sabonis trade value, it gets a little bit weird, and it's not necessarily because, you know, the fact that, you know, he's not necessarily that good of a player, because I don't think that teams look at him that way. It's more so the fit and, you know, the what he brings to the table, and is he going to have a legitimate impact and make a difference if I trade for him and give up some of my key assets. In terms of, you know, Golden State, I doubt Golden State pulls the plug once again, because they've got assets for days. I mean, Kuminga, Moody, Andrew Wiggins, you name it. And essentially, if you trade for Domantas Sabonis, you're more than likely going to have to get rid of Wiggins due to the contracts just being even. And, you know, with that being said, I doubt that Golden State pulls the plug on that. I do have similar questions about the, not necessarily the fit, but just how he's going to be utilized. Because essentially, Sabonis, he really is at his best when you try to maximize him and, you know, cater to his needs, essentially. Yeah. You know, you kind of have to force feed him a little bit if you want to see noticeable impact. And if I'm the Golden State Warriors, I don't think that I really would want to rely on that too much. Like, isolation on a lower block with Domantas Sabonis, it's not bad, but I think the Warriors' offense, as of right now, it's a lot better to, you know, keep the pieces and assets that they have currently on the team. But let's switch over to Myles Turner, because he's obviously probably got the highest trade value out of all of these guys. And Greg, I want to get an insight on where you would like to see him play next.
Yeah, Myles Turner is a guy, you know, stretch big, who can, you know, stretch it out to the three, great in a pick and roll. I mean, has a decent post game. I think he can help on the offensive end, but really his big question is his rim protection. I mean, that's what he's known for. I mean, he's great, averages 2.7 blocks. I mean, this guy can really protect the rim, has great awareness, great lateral quickness, great quickness, moves very good as a big. And I think teams that should open, you know, jump at the bid to get him is the Hornets, Trailblazers, and surprisingly the Lakers, but I have nicely talked about that. I think the Hornets for sure need a big. I think what Turner brings is way better what Mason Plumlee brings, and I think pick and roll with LaMelo on the offensive end with Myles Turner would be amazing. And on the defensive end, I think it just helps him out in the interior and not give up easy baskets at the rim. And then for the Trailblazers, I think Nurkic, I think with his injury and with injuries with his leg, that crazy injury that we saw a couple years ago to his leg, I think we're not seeing the same lateral quickness that he used to have in a defensive end. I think bringing a guy in like Myles Turner, especially to a defense that is terrible this year, will definitely help them in the rim protection and on pick and roll situations that I think Myles Turner is definitely better at than Nurkic. So I think those two teams should definitely should be open to getting for trading for Myles Turner for sure, nicely.
Yeah, I mean, bringing up the Lakers, if the Lakers are going to continue to run these double big lineups, I mean, implementing Myles Turner into that alongside Anthony Davis is probably the best bet that you're going to get, right? You know, yeah. I mean, maybe it does get a little bit crowded in the interior, but you know what? They're going to have a lot more opportunities to get second chance points. We don't have to rely on, you know, our bench unit, like guys like Wayne Ellington and Carmelo Anthony, to have to, you know, shoot threes to get us back into the game, and, you know, LeBron James carrying the offense and all that good stuff, obviously. But yeah, Myles Turner in LA, I think I would like it. You know, this is a team that also needs help on the defensive end. You know, he provides rim protection, really going to alleviate some of those guards getting blown past and, you know, limiting the offensive production that the opposing players are going to have. And then on top of that, he did play for Frank Vogel in Indiana during, you know, Vogel's tenure and all that. So it's not like Vogel is going to be unfamiliar with his game or anything. And he should be able to try to implement him to the best of his ability if, you know, the Lakers would be able to trade for him. But I don't think that they have the assets currently right now. But another team that I would love to see, you know, Myles Turner on, Charlotte. I think, you know, LaMelo Ball would benefit having him as a screener in the pick and roll. They can utilize him in, you know, regular pick and roll, DHOs potentially. And, you know, Hornets in Spain pick and roll as well. I think teams would have a really hard time scheming for that because, you know, obviously diving to the basket, Myles Turner should be a threat. He's also somebody that, you know, you can throw the ball down to into the lower block and, you know, allow him to go to work from there. Does need a little bit of help in terms of, you know, spacing the floor out. You know, he can't shoot threes or anything of that nature. And he's probably average compared to, you know, the rest of the centers in the NBA in terms of, you know, just being able to knock down a 15-footer. But that's not even going to be his role down there in Charlotte. So outside of that, I really like the addition of Myles Turner potentially. The only thing is, what assets are you going to have to give up? And is it really going to be all that much of a plus, especially for a team that, you know, isn't really going to be in championship contention overall? But let me know what you guys think about this situation in the comment section. Thank you guys so much for tuning in to another episode of me and Greg on the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're new to our YouTube channel or you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice little review. But besides that, it's your boy Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host Greg King, and we out.
We out.